You wanna go, you wanna leave. So baby, come and get away with me. You wanna go, you wanna leave.
So like I was talking about this welding certificate, I told you I had one through the refinery, but never through the union. I've never got a welding certificate through the union at this time. So I went down and talked to them, and they were gonna find me a job as a pipe fitter. But I also, you know, with the union, it's like, it's good to be a journeyman pipe fitter, but it's also good to have a skill as a welder. And what I mean by that is, you know, like a pipe fitter is looked at like being a dime a dozen, but if you have a welding cert underneath your belt, you know, you're more valuable than just being just a pipe fitter. Because when there's heavy layoffs or stuff like that, usually they keep the welders working year round just because they have that extra skill set underneath their belt. Where a pipe fitter, they might lay them off just depending on how good they are and what they know and how valuable they are. And so I go back to the union, and like I say, I haven't done much welding in the past 3 years. I've done 4 x-ray welds in like 3 years' time, so that's hardly any welding at all. And so I needed to take a test. I would have to get practice up. And to do any kind of test for the union, a pipe weld test, it's very, very hard. There's like 6 inspection hold points. And then even if they say it's good, they still send it off to California to get x-rayed. And so you knew I knew that I would have to practice a little bit before I get in there and take any kind of test. And so while I was in Wyoming, like I say, I put all my stuff in a storage and I stayed at my mother's house. And the lease was almost up on my Wyoming property. So the plan was, when the lease was up, they were gonna move out anyway. So I would just go and stay back at my first house I bought. And it was a nice house anyways, you know. We took very good care of it, you know, it was an awesome house. And so I went down to the union hall and practiced for like, I think it was 2 or 3 days. I practiced welding, just getting ready for that test. And on the 4th day, I took that weld test and I ended up passing it. So that was good. And before I even passed the test, I ended up getting a job at a powerhouse in Wheatland, Wyoming. That was about 70 miles north of Cheyenne. Big, huge powerhouse up there. And I started working that powerhouse. And while I was up there, they gave me the news that I passed the welding test. So I was like, right on, things are falling into place, you know? And so I'm up there working that job and everything. And we're doing a turnaround mode. And that means, you know, 7 12-hour days, because they had a scheduled turnaround to get all this work done. And when they do that, they bring in all kinds of union hands, like people that aren't, you know, usually on the job, just even people from out of town. They bring in all these guys to work this job. And so we're working 7 12-hour days, stuff like that. Well, one day I was working and my boss told me, he says, well, you're gonna have a new guy working with you today. He's a welding inspector from Las Vegas or something. And I said, oh, okay. And I didn't really say anything about it. I didn't know. And I was expecting like an old guy to come work with me, you know, like an old welding inspector or something. I didn't know if he was an inspector just coming down to inspect, or if he was a guy who had his welding. I didn't know, you know, and I didn't ask all those questions. So this guy shows up on the job, and his name was Joe, and he's a Mexican dude, right around my age, might have been like a year older. And I think I asked him, you know, and he said, yeah, I'm a welding inspector or whatever. And I said, oh, that's pretty cool or whatever. And I didn't get into it. I didn't ask him much more after that. And we just talked with each other, shared, you know, our experiences and where he wanted to go and stuff like that. And he was even like saying, yeah, you know, I like to push myself and do this and try to do the best I can with my life. And so we worked together for a little while, like probably about a month or month and a half. And then he left, he went, you know, cause the turnaround was almost over with. So that's the only time we really spent together. And then after the turnaround was over, you know, a lot of people usually leave after turnarounds and get something closer to home, or hit the road for more turnaround, big money or whatever. And my boss asked me, he says, well, we really like you and you're a damn good worker. So would you be interested in sticking around working 40 hours around here? And I said, sure, you know, I don't care. I just want a job and something to do. Well, at this time I started working there, I really started reading a lot of books. In my free time at lunch and everything, I'd read a lot of books, you know. And shortly after that, Hang ends up coming down from Kansas and staying with me. So she's staying with me and things are going good. She didn't come down and stay with me until I got my house back. So I had my house back, she's with me, things are going good, I can't complain. And me and her, like, we just start working out a lot, going to the gym like almost every night, and I'm reading a lot of books and just trying to take life easy, you know. And she's taking it easy too. I tell her, don't worry about looking for a job right away, you know, just take it easy, and when you're ready you can. So as more and more time goes by, I end up running across this book, and it's called 100K Welder. So I was like, what's this book all about? I bought it off the internet. And I started reading through that book, and it just tells you, you know, how to make $100,000 or more a year, you know, as a welder. And, you know, it talk about how to get your welding certs, pipeline welding, and even talk about certified welding inspector in there, or even open up your own school. And it would list like the highest professions and what they get paid in the welding area. So I was thinking, maybe I should, you know, look into this being a welding inspector, you know. And I thought, maybe that's pretty cool. And so that was just a back thought at the time. And so right around this time, you know, the union hall asked me if I wanted to teach some classes to the apprentices. And I thought, no way. I said, yeah, I'm interested. That'd be an honor, you know. You know, first of all, years ago, I was barely getting into the apprenticeship, learning the ropes. Now they're asking me to come back and help teach classes to the apprentices. So I said, yeah, you know, I'll teach classes. So they paid me and everything like that. And I think I only, I taught for a semester, so that's 4 or 5 months long. And it was cool, you know, because I taught them hands-on skills. I told them welding skills, different rods, you know, pipe threading machines, offsets, you know, just pretty much everything I knew I taught them. Tube bending, steam tracing, you know, just everything. I just poured out everything and just got them up on all their math skills and everything. But I thought it was a real honor to be able to teach my skills to other people, you know. Especially, like, I never thought that they would ask me to come teach class, so I thought it was cool. So I'd done that for a semester, and they paid me and everything, and everybody was happy, and I was happy, and stuff like that. So after teaching, you know, that's when I ran across that 100K Welder book, and I really started looking into being a welding inspector. And I thought, man, you know, maybe I should go after this welding inspector. So I started researching it, and you know, I thought, well, what's involved? Well, it's $2,000 just to take the test. And the code book was $400, and it was a week-long course, and you had to take off work, and you had to submit paperwork, you had to submit an application with an eye test in there, plus like all these hoops you had to jump through. I had to get like three recommended letters from previous employers that I worked for, verifying my weld history and saying what kind of person I was. It's just, you just had to jump through like tons of hoops just to get all this paperwork submitted. And then after you submitted all the paperwork, you had to pay $2,000, you know, just to take the test, and $400 for the code book. So, you know, I knew it was going to be something serious. So at the time, I contacted Joe, and he didn't talk me into getting certified as a welding inspector, but I called him, and I said that I plan on going to take my test, and he encouraged me. He's like, oh, right on, dude. So he sent me some study stuff that I could study from, and, you know, I really looked at life and everything, and I was like, well, if I'm going to go after this welding certification, this welding inspector certification, I'm going to have to change some things in my life. And so at the time I was watching, you know, TV and stuff like that, wasting a few hours a night watching TV. And the bill was like $130, $140 a month. So I ended up calling up the TV company and I canceled it. I canceled TV, you know, and I just kept internet, you know, so we could get on there once in a while. And I said, if I really want this to be a certified welding inspector, I'm going to have to cut this out of my life and focus. So I cut TV out of my life, stopped watching it. And like I say, I was hitting the gym a lot with Hang. And I even knew that studying was more important than going to the gym also. So I wouldn't go to the, sometimes I'd miss the gym. I wouldn't go to the gym even though I loved it. You know, just so I could get studied up so I could have a good possibility of getting this welding cert, this welding inspection certificate. So I start studying like 3 months in advance, just reading over this code book, studying all the material I could get my hands on, everything. And then the time comes up for me to test, and it's in Denver, Colorado is where I'm gonna go test. I had to take off work for a whole week, go down there, and it was a week-long seminar where they get you studied up on the code and general knowledge and practical and everything. And then you take the test on the following Saturday or Sunday, just depending on where you fell. And it's a funny thing because, you know, even though I wanted to go take this test, I had some family members and a couple friends, you know, pretty much saying, oh, I don't think you're going to make it. You shouldn't even risk that kind of money. That's a big amount of money to risk. You know, I don't think you're going to make it. And you know what I did? I shut them all off. Like, because I wasn't even trying to listen to any negativity coming my way. So I didn't even listen to what they had to say. Even though they were saying negative, I was just like, well, whatever. This is what I want to go after. So this is what I'm going to go after. So I went and tested down in Denver, Colorado. And even after your test is done with, you know, like, I was so exhausted just from the seminar and testing, you know. It's crazy. So after this test was done with, you don't get the results back till like a month later. So a month later, I end up getting my results back and I end up passing. I was a certified welding inspector then. So I was real happy and excited and everything like that. And I just wanted to progress with my life and move on to the next chapter. You know, I always loved welding and pipe fitting and stuff like that, but I was looking at, well, I'm going to get old one day and stuff like that, and I don't want to be working real hard out there in the field, you know. I want to have an easier job, just come up and inspect some welds, you know. Go back to my office, write up documents, you know, take it easy on myself. And so that's what I was looking at like 30 years old. I was already looking at trying to create that kind of lifestyle for me in advance so it'll be there. And so I'm real happy, you know, I got my welding inspection certificate and everything, so everything's going good, you know, I can't complain. Well, right around this time, Hang, she can't find a job in Cheyenne. And she's been there like 9 months with no job, and you know, she's starting to feel down and out and everything like that. So she calls up one of her friends, and her friend in Wichita, Kansas, and her friend says, well, if you come back to Wichita, I'm sure I could get you a job with aircraft. And so me and Hang talked it over, and you know, everything was going good with me and my son. I was seeing him all the time. Visitation rights were established. Everything was going good. But his mom was married to a guy at the time that she had her kids with. And I found out the little girl that she had wasn't even my kid. You know, it was another guy's kid. So that's like a weight lifted off my shoulders. Well, when I moved down to Kansas in 2010, she got married to another guy, and that was the baby's father anyways, and then they had a couple more kids together. So they were married, and after I got certified as a welding inspector in Cheyenne, Wyoming, she wanted to move to Utah, and she was gonna take my son and everything like that. So I was like, well, I don't know what to do, you know? And I had no say in it at the time or whatever, because court's kind of weird down there. So her and my son and her husband ended up moving to Utah. So, you know, I was down in Wyoming, you know, to be around my son, but then they moved to Utah. And Hank's talking to me about, you know, well, your friend could get her a job back in Wichita, Kansas, and what do I think? And so we come up with a plan that, that I would stay work for a few months down in Wyoming for that contractor. She could go out there, get a job, and get a place stable. And then I would follow her, you know, because my son already moved to Utah at the time. And there wasn't really that much for me back in Cheyenne anyways, except for like my mom, some of my family, you know. So I was really wanting to pursue a relationship and a life with Hang, you know. And so that's what I did, you know. She moved up there and she bought a little small house for like $60,000. And because we thought about things, she says, what should I do? Should I rent an apartment or what? And I says, well, just buy another little house. You know, it could be a good investment property. She said, well, you're right, you know. So she ended up buying a small house in Wichita, Kansas. And the plan was is I'd move up there after she was stable and everything was good to go. So just go ahead and stick around with me, guys. I got a lot more crazy stuff that happens after this. Subscribe if you haven't. Subscribe down below. Hit the bell icon. And I appreciate you guys staying with me to hear my story. And I got a lot more coming. Stick around. We'll catch you on the next one. Bye.